Good evening, everyone. To begin, let's start off with Manava Gita. Menstrual blood is the only source of blood that is not traumatically induced. Yet, in modern society, this is the most hidden blood, the one so rarely spoken of, almost never seen, except privately by women. We are living in a society where there are many steadfast beliefs on menstruation. This, in turn, ruins the future of many girls which include prohibiting them from completing their education, to make them isolated and not permitting them to interact with each other during this period. On this year's International Girl Child Day, we NSS Unit 552 and 618 of College of Engineering Aramulla is here with a webinar and a campaign on menstrual hygiene. Now, for the welcome speech, I would like to call upon Mr. Balakumar sir.
Good evening, all of you. Aramulla Engineering College in the NSS unit, the Loga Baliga Dinavumayi Bandhappetta ഒരു പ്രോഗ്രാം സംഘടിപ്പിച്ചിരിക്കുകയാണ്. 2012 തൊട്ടാണ് ഒക്ടോബർ 1 തൊട്ട് ഐക്യരാഷ്ട്ര സംഘടന ലോക ബാലികാ ദിനമായി ആചരിച്ചു വരുന്നു. 2012 തൊട്ടാണ് ഐക്യരാഷ്ട്ര സംഘടന ലോക ബാലികാ ദിനമായിട്ട് ആചരിച്ചു തുടങ്ങുന്നത്. നമുക്കറിയാം, പെൺകുട്ടികൾ സമൂഹത്തിൽ നേരിടുന്ന, സൊസൈറ്റിയിൽ നേരിടുന്ന പലതരത്തിലുള്ള ഡിസ്ക്രിമിനേഷനെതിരെ ഒരു അവബോധം, അതായത് വിദ്യാഭ്യാസ രംഗത്തും പോഷകാഹാരം, അതുപോലെ തന്നെ ചൈൽഡ് മാരേജ്, ശൈശവ വിവാഹം, നിയമപരമായിട്ടുള്ള അവകാശങ്ങളും മെഡിക്കൽ അവകാശം എന്നിവയെ കുറിച്ചൊരു അവബോധം വരുത്തുന്നതിന് വേണ്ടിയാണ് ഈ ലോക ബാലികാ ദിനം ആചരിക്കുന്നത്. അതിനൊരു അവബോധം വരുത്തുക എന്നുള്ളതാണ്, കുട്ടികൾക്ക്, പെൺകുട്ടികൾക്ക് ഒരു അവബോധം വരുത്തുക എന്നുള്ളതാണ് ലോക ബാലികാ ദിനത്തിന്റെ പ്രധാനപ്പെട്ട ലക്ഷ്യമെന്ന് പറയുന്നത്. ഈ പരിപാടി ഉദ്ഘാടനം ചെയ്യുന്ന ഡിസ്ട്രിക്ട് വുമൺ ആൻഡ് ചൈൽഡ് ഡെവലപ്മെന്റ് ഓഫീസർ പത്തനംതിട്ട മിസ്സിസ് തെസ്നീം പി എസ് മേഡത്തെ ഹാർദവമായി ഈ പ്രോഗ്രാമിലേക്ക് സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്യുന്നു. അടുത്തതായിട്ട് ഈ പ്രോഗ്രാമിന്റെ അധ്യക്ഷ പദവി അലങ്കരിക്കുന്ന നമ്മുടെ കോളേജ് പ്രിൻസിപ്പാൾ ഡോക്ടർ സജീഷ് അവരെയും ഈ പ്രോഗ്രാമിലേക്ക് ഹാർദവമായി സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്യുന്നു. ഈ പ്രോഗ്രാമിലേക്ക് ആശംസ അറിയിക്കുന്നതിനായി പങ്കെടുക്കുന്ന കൊല്ലം പത്തനംതിട്ട റീജിയണൽ കോർഡിനേറ്റർ ഷാറോസ് അദ്ദേഹത്തെ ഈ പ്രോഗ്രാമിലേക്ക് ഹാർദവമായി സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്യുന്നു. കൂടാതെ ലോക ബാലികാ ദിനവുമായി ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട് സെക്ഷണൽ ക്ലാസ് എടുക്കുന്ന എൻ ജി ഒ ടീം അംഗമായ ഡോക്ടർ ഇഷ കപൂറിനെയും ഈ പ്രോഗ്രാമിലേക്ക് ഹാർദവമായി സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്യുന്നു. കൂടാതെ കോളേജ് പ്രോഗ്രാം ഓഫീസർ അനൂപ് സാറിനെയും മറ്റു പ്രോഗ്രാം ഓഫീസർമാരെയും എൻ എസ് എസ് ഭാരവാഹികളായ അംഗങ്ങളായ ഈ പ്രോഗ്രാമിലേക്ക് സസന്തോഷം സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്യുന്നു. നന്ദി, നമസ്കാരം.
താങ്ക് യു സർ. For the presidential address, I cordially invite our principal, Dr. Sajeev sir.
Respected Chief Guest, SNAPS, other guests, Saros, faculty members, Anup, Priyanka, Balakumar, invited guests. My dear students and my dear NSS volunteers. കഴിഞ്ഞ ആഴ്ച അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഇവിടുത്തെ ആഴ്ചയാണ് കോളേജിലെ ഒരു സ്റ്റുഡൻറ്റ് ബെസ്റ്റ് NSS വോളണ്ടിയറായിട്ട് അവാർഡ് വാങ്ങിയത്. സ്റ്റേറ്റ് വൈഡ് ലിമിറ്റഡ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള കുട്ടികൾക്കാണ് അത് കിട്ടുന്നത്. പത്തി താഴെയോ ആ റേഞ്ചിലുള്ള ഒരു സെലക്ഷൻ സ്റ്റേറ്റ് വൈഡ്, അതിലൊരാളാണ് നമ്മുടെ NSS വോളണ്ടിയർ. അപ്പൊ എല്ലാ സമയത്തും നമുക്ക് കോളേജിന് അഭിമാനത്തോടുകൂടി ഓർക്കാനുള്ള ഒരു പ്രവർത്തനമാണ് NSS യൂണിറ്റ് എല്ലാ സമയവും കാഴ്ചവെക്കുന്നത്. ഈ പാസ്റ്റ് ഇയറിൽ പോലും ഇത്രയും കോവിഡും പ്രയാസങ്ങളും ഉണ്ടായിരുന്ന സമയത്തും നമ്മുടെ ഒരു സ്റ്റുഡൻറ്റ് ഹൈ ലെവലിൽ പെർഫോമൻസ് കാഴ്ചവെച്ച് ബെസ്റ്റ് വോളണ്ടിയർ അവാർഡ് നേടിയത്. ഇവിടെ അഡ്മിഷന്റെ പല തിരക്കാണ്, കുട്ടികൾ എന്നെ വെയിറ്റ് ചെയ്ത് നിൽക്കുകയാണ്. അതുകൊണ്ട് ഞാനൊരു ലെങ്തി സ്പീച്ചിന് തയ്യാറാവുന്നില്ല. ബാലകുമാർ തന്നെ ഈ പ്രോഗ്രാമിന്റെ സിഗ്നിഫിക്കൻസ് എല്ലാം സൂചിപ്പിച്ചു. ഈ ബാക്കിയുള്ള കാര്യങ്ങൾ നമ്മുടെ ചീഫ് ഗസ്റ്റ് ഇനാഗുറേഷൻ ചെയ്യുന്ന സമയത്ത് സംസാരിക്കും. നമ്മുടെ ഗസ്റ്റ് ബാക്കി എല്ലാവരും ഇത് ഡീറ്റെയിൽഡ് ആയിട്ട് നിങ്ങളോട് സംസാരിക്കും. ഇവിടെ ഡിപ്ലോമയുടെ അഡ്മിഷൻ നടക്കുന്ന കുട്ടികൾ വെയിറ്റ് ചെയ്യുന്നു. ആ ഒരു കാരണം കൊണ്ട് ഞാൻ കൂടുതൽ ദീർഘിപ്പിക്കുന്നില്ല. എന്റെ എല്ലാവിധ ആശംസകളും നേർന്നുകൊണ്ട് ഞാൻ നിർത്തുന്നു. താങ്ക് യു വെരി മച്ച്.
Thank you, sir. Moving on with the inauguration, I warmly welcome our chief guest, District Woman and Child Development Officer, Pathanamthitta, Mrs. Tasneem P.S.
Good afternoon, all. Am I audible to all of you? Kekamo, because
yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Kekamo?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
കേൾക്കാൻ പറ്റുന്നുണ്ടോ?
യെസ് മാം, യു ആർ ഓഡിബിൾ.
ആ ഓക്കേ ഓക്കേ. ഇറ്റ്സ് ഹെവിലി റെയിനിങ് ഹിയർ ആൻഡ് ഇൻ മൈ ഓഫീസ്. ഫസ്റ്റ് ഓഫ് ഓൾ ഐ വുഡ് ലൈക്ക് ടു കൺഗ്രാറ്റുലേറ്റ് ദ ടീം ഫോർ പ്ലാനിംഗ് സച്ച് എ സെഷൻ on International Girl Child Day itself. Respected college principal, NSS program officers, and dearest students, വളരെയധികം സന്തോഷമുണ്ട് ഇന്ന് ഇത്തരത്തിലൊരു പ്രോഗ്രാമിൽ പങ്കെടുക്കുന്നതിനായിട്ട് എന്നെ ഇൻവൈറ്റ് ചെയ്തതിന്. നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഏവർക്കും അറിയുന്നത് പോലെ ഇന്ന് അന്താരാഷ്ട്ര ഗേൾ ചൈൽഡ് ഡേ ആയിട്ട് ആചരിക്കുകയാണ്. നേരത്തെ സംസാരിച്ച അധ്യാപകൻ സൂചിപ്പിച്ച പോലെ തന്നെ ജെൻഡർ ഇക്വിറ്റബിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു സൊസൈറ്റി ഇനിയും സൃഷ്ടിക്കപ്പെടാത്തത് കൊണ്ട് തന്നെയാണ് ഇത്തരം ദിനങ്ങൾ നമ്മൾ ആചരിക്കേണ്ടി വരുന്നത്. ജെൻഡർ ഇക്വിറ്റബിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഈക്വൽ ആയിട്ടുള്ള എല്ലാവർക്കും ഈക്വൽ ആക്സസ് ഉള്ള ആണിനും പെണ്ണിനും ഈക്വൽ ആക്സസ് ഉള്ള ഒരു സൊസൈറ്റിയിൽ ഇത്തരം ദിനാചരണങ്ങളുടെ പ്രസക്തി ഉണ്ടാവില്ല. പക്ഷെ ഇപ്പോഴും നമ്മൾ ബഹുദൂരം പെൺകുട്ടികളുടെ അവസ്ഥ, പ്രത്യേകിച്ച് നമ്മുടെ പോലെയുള്ള വികസിച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്ന രാജ്യങ്ങളിൽ, ഡെവലപ്പിംഗ് കൺട്രീസിൽ വളരെയധികം പുറകോട്ട് നിൽക്കുന്നതുകൊണ്ടാണ് ഇത്തരത്തിലുള്ള ദിനങ്ങൾ നമ്മൾ ആ ഒരു ലക്ഷ്യം മുൻനിർത്തി ജെൻഡർ ഇക്വിറ്റബിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ജെൻഡർ ഇക്വാലിറ്റിയിലെ സമത്വത്തിലേക്കുള്ള ഒരു പാതയിലേക്ക് എത്തുന്നതിന് വേണ്ടിയിട്ടുള്ള മുദ്രാവാക്യങ്ങൾ ഉയർത്തിപ്പിടിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് അത്തരം പ്രവർത്തനങ്ങൾ ഗവൺമെന്റ് ഏജൻസീസ് ഏറ്റെടുത്ത് നടപ്പിലാക്കുന്നതിന്റെ ഭാഗമായിട്ടാണ് ഇത്തരം ദിവസങ്ങൾ നമ്മൾ ആചരിക്കുന്നത്. ഒന്ന് മേജർ ആയിട്ടുള്ള അഡൽസന്റ് ഒരു ഹെൽത്ത് ഇഷ്യൂ കൂടെയാണ് മെൻസ്ട്രൽ ഹൈജീൻ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത്. മെൻസ്ട്രുവേഷൻ റിലേറ്റഡ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരുപാട് ഇഷ്യൂസ് നമ്മുടെ സ്കൂളില് കുട്ടികള് ഇടയിൽ നമുക്ക് കാണാൻ പറ്റുന്നതാണ്. അതിനെക്കുറിച്ചുള്ള അവബോധം ഇപ്പോൾ നമ്മൾ തന്നെ വിവിധ കോളേജുകളിലും സ്കൂൾസിലും പ്രോഗ്രാം നടത്തുമ്പോൾ പലപ്പോഴും ഇത്തരത്തിലുള്ള ബേസിക് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഇതുമായിട്ട് ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട ചില അറിവുകൾ പോലും നമ്മുടെ കേരളത്തിൽ അടക്കമുള്ള കുട്ടികളിൽ കാണാൻ കണ്ടിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഒരുപാട് ആരോഗ്യ പ്രശ്നങ്ങളിലേക്ക് എത്തിക്കുന്ന ഒരു രീതിയും നമ്മൾ കണ്ടിട്ടുണ്ട്. അവരുടെ മെൻസ്ട്രൽ ഹൈജീനുമായിട്ട് ബന്ധപ്പെട്ടുള്ള ഒരു അവബോധം പേരൻസിന്റെ അടുത്തുനിന്നോ മറ്റു ആൾക്കാരുടെ അടുത്തുനിന്നോ കിട്ടാത്തത് കൊണ്ട് തന്നെ ചില ഇൻഫെർട്ടിലിറ്റി അടക്കം ലേറ്റർ ഓൺ ഇൻ ദിയർ ലൈഫ് ഇൻഫെർട്ടിലിറ്റി, കിഡ്നി അങ്ങനെയുള്ള റിലേറ്റഡ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഡിസീസ് വരെ വരുമെന്നാണ് നമ്മുടെ പല പഠനങ്ങളിലും അല്ലാതെ തന്നെ വിദഗ്ധരായിട്ടുള്ള ആൾക്കാർ പറയുന്നത്. ഇപ്പൊ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഇന്നത്തെ പ്രോഗ്രാം കൈകാര്യം ചെയ്യുന്നതിന് ഏറ്റവും ഉചിതമായിട്ടുള്ള ഡോക്ടറായിട്ടുള്ളതിന് ഒരു ഗൈനക്കോളജിസ്റ്റ് ആയിട്ടുള്ളതിന് ഒരാൾ എത്തിയിട്ടുണ്ടെന്ന് അറിയാം. അപ്പോ ഇന്നത്തെ ദിവസം തന്നെ ഇത്തരം ഒരു പരിപാടി ഓർഗനൈസ് ചെയ്തതിൽ ഞാൻ എല്ലാ ടീമംഗങ്ങളെയും കൺഗ്രാജുലേറ്റ് ചെയ്യാണ്. അപ്പൊ നമ്മുടെ ജില്ല ഇതുമായിട്ട് ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട അല്ലെങ്കിലും നമ്മൾ വനിതാ ശിശു വികസന വകുപ്പ് എല്ലാ കോളേജുകളിലും കനൽ എന്ന ഒരു ക്യാമ്പയിൻ ലോഞ്ച് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഇതിന്റെ ഭാഗമായിട്ട് ജെൻഡർ വിദ്യാഭ്യാസമാണ് നമ്മൾ മെയിൻലി നൽകുന്നത്. ജെൻഡറും സെക്സ് എഡ്യൂക്കേഷനും അതിന്റെ ഭാഗമായിട്ട് നമ്മൾ നൽകിക്കൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്നുണ്ട്. കേരളത്തില് വനിതാ ശിശു വികസന വകുപ്പ് ഇസ് കണ്ടക്ടിങ് എ സീരീസ് ഓഫ് പ്രോഗ്രാംസ് ഓൺ ജെൻഡർ ആൻഡ് ജെൻഡർ സെൻസിറ്റൈസേഷൻ. അപ്പൊ നിങ്ങളുടെ കോളേജിലും വളരെ അധികം താമസിയാതെ തന്നെ നമ്മൾ പ്രോഗ്രാമുമായിട്ട് വരുന്നതാണ്. അപ്പൊ നമ്മുടെ വകുപ്പ് ഇതുമായിട്ട് ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട ഒരുപാട് ഒരുപിടി നിയമങ്ങൾ നിങ്ങൾക്കറിയാമല്ലോ. ഈ അടുത്ത കാലത്തെ ഉള്ള സംഭവങ്ങളൊക്കെ തന്നെ, കേരളത്തിൽ നടക്കുന്ന സംഭവങ്ങളൊക്കെ തന്നെ നിങ്ങളുടെ യുവാക്കളുടെ ഇടയിൽ ചർച്ച ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ടാവും ഞാൻ കരുതുന്നു. നിധീന സംഭവം, വിസ്മയ സംഭവം, ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള കാര്യങ്ങളുടെ ഒക്കെ തന്നെ ഒരു പിന്നെ റൂട്ട് കോസ് നോക്കുമ്പോൾ നമ്മുടെ പാട്രിയാർക്കലായിട്ടുള്ള മിഥ്യാബോധങ്ങളും അത് ഉണ്ടാക്കിയെടുക്കുന്ന ടോക്സിക് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ബന്ധങ്ങളിലേക്ക് നയിക്കുന്ന സാമൂഹിക സാഹചര്യങ്ങളുമാണ്. അപ്പം ഒരു ഹെൽത്തി ആയിട്ടുള്ള ആൺ പെൺ ബന്ധം നിങ്ങളുടെ പോലെ ഒരു സൊസൈറ്റിയിൽ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ കോളേജുകളിൽ വിദ്യാലയങ്ങളിൽ നമ്മൾ വളർന്നു വരുന്ന ചുറ്റുപാടുകളിൽ ഉണ്ടാകാത്തത് കൊണ്ട് തന്നെയാണ് ഇത്തരം ടോക്സിക് റിലേഷൻഷിപ്സിലേക്ക് എത്തിക്കുന്നതും അത് അവസാനം മർഡറിലേക്ക് ഇത്രയും ക്രൂരമായിട്ടുള്ള ഇൻസിഡൻസിലേക്ക് നയിക്കുന്നത്. അപ്പൊ നിങ്ങളുടെ ഇടയിൽ എനിക്ക് ഏറ്റവും സന്തോഷം കൂടിയത് ആൺകുട്ടികളും പെൺകുട്ടികളും ഒരുമിച്ചിരുന്നാണ് മെൻസ്ട്രൽ ഹൈജീനെ കുറിച്ചൊരു ക്ലാസ് കേൾക്കാൻ പോകുന്നത്. അത് തന്നെ ഏറ്റവും വലിയൊരു നല്ലൊരു സൂചനയായിട്ട് നല്ലൊരു സന്തോഷമുള്ള ഒരു കാര്യമാണ്. കാരണം പെൺകുട്ടികളെ പോലെ തന്നെ ആൺകുട്ടികളും മെൻസ്ട്രൽ ഹൈജീനെ കുറിച്ച് അറിഞ്ഞിരിക്കണം. കോളേജിൽ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നിങ്ങളുടെ സഹപാഠികളായ പെൺ കുട്ടികൾക്ക് ഉണ്ടാവുന്ന ഇത്തരം അവരുടെ ജൈവികമായിട്ടുള്ള പ്രക്രിയയിൽ ഉണ്ടാവുന്ന കാര്യങ്ങൾ തന്നെ നിങ്ങൾ യങ് അഡൾട്ട് ആയിരിക്കുമ്പോൾ പോലെ ആയിരിക്കുമ്പോൾ തന്നെ അറിഞ്ഞാൽ മാത്രമേ ആ ഒരു അവസ്ഥയായിട്ട് എംപതൈസ് ചെയ്യാനും അവർക്ക് അതുമായിട്ട് ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട ഒരു നീഡ് ഉണ്ടായാൽ കൂടി നിങ്ങളുടെ അടുത്ത് തുറന്നു പറയാൻ സങ്കോചമില്ലാതെ തുറന്നു പറയാനും സ്കൂളിലാണെങ്കിലും അല്ലെങ്കിൽ കോളേജസിലാണെങ്കിലും ഇത്തരം സൗകര്യങ്ങളടക്കം വിമൻ ഫ്രണ്ട്ലി ആയിട്ടുള്ള റെസ്റ്റ് റൂമും പ്രോപ്പർ ആയിട്ടുള്ള സാനിറ്ററി പാഡ്സ് അവൈലബിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള വെൻഡിങ് മെഷീൻ സ്ഥാപിച്ചിട്ടുള്ള പ്രോപ്പർ ആയിട്ടുള്ള റെസ്റ്റ് റൂംസ് ഉള്ള തുറന്ന് ഇത്തരം വിഷയം ഉണ്ടായാൽ തന്നെ ഇത്തരം കാര്യങ്ങൾ കൂടി നിങ്ങളുടെ ചങ്ങാതിമാരെ ആൺകുട്ടികളോട് സ്വതന്ത്രമായിട്ട് ഒരു ജാള്യതയും കൂടാതെ പീരിയഡ്സ് ആണെങ്കിൽ കൂടി പറയാൻ പറ്റണം. നിങ്ങൾക്കൊരു ഒരു വിഷമിച്ചിരുന്നാണ്ട് ടുഡേ ഐ എം സ്റ്റാർട്ടിങ് മൈ പീരിയഡ്സ് എന്ന് സ്വതന്ത്രമായിട്ട് പറയാൻ പറ്റുന്ന രീതിയിൽ മനുഷ്യത്വപരമായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു ലെവലിലേക്ക് പോകണം. എന്താ പറയാ, അതിനൊരു പിന്നെ അശ്ലീലമായുള്ള അല്ലെങ്കിൽ മോശമായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു ടോപ്പിക്കായിട്ട് മാറ്റി നിർത്താതെ മനുഷ്യനാണ്, സ്ത്രീയും പുരുഷനും തമ്മിലുള്ള ജൈവികമായിട്ടുള്ള വ്യത്യാസങ്ങൾ മനസ്സിലാക്കി പരസ്പരം വെറും ശരീരമായിട്ട് ചുരുക്കി കാണാതെ പൂർണ്ണമായിട്ടുള്ള മനസ്സും സ്വപ്നങ്ങളും ശരീരവും എല്ലാം ഉള്ള സ്ത്രീകളായിട്ട് സ്ത്രീകളെ അംഗീകരിക്കുന്ന ആൺകുട്ടികൾ ഉണ്ടാവണം. പരസ്പരം ആ പരസ്പരമായിട്ട് അത്തരത്തിലുള്ള അംഗീകാരവും ആദരവും തുറന്നെല്ലാം സംസാരിക്കാൻ പറ്റുന്ന ആരോഗ്യകരമായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു ആൺ ബന്ധം ഉണ്ടാവണമെങ്കിൽ ഇത്തരത്തിലുള്ള വിഷയങ്ങളടക്കം തുല്യ പങ്കാളിത്തത്തോടുകൂടി ചർച്ച ചെയ്യേണ്ടതിന്റെ ഒരു പ്രാധാന്യം ഇന്നുണ്ട്. അത് ഇല്ലാത്തതാണ് നമ്മളെ കേരളത്തിൽ തന്നെ കഴിഞ്ഞ 2 വർഷമായിട്ട് നമ്മൾ മുമ്പിൽ വരുന്ന പ്രശ്നങ്ങളും മർഡേഴ്സ് പെൺകുട്ടികളുടെ മരണങ്ങൾ ഇതുമായിട്ട് ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട മർഡേഴ്സും സൂയിസൈഡ്സും നോക്കിക്കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ഇത്തരത്തിലുള്ള വിശ്വാസങ്ങളുടെ ഭാഗമായിട്ട് പാട്രിയാർക്കലായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു സമൂഹം പുരുഷ മേധാവിത്വ സമൂഹത്തിന്റെ ഭാഗമായിട്ടുണ്ടായിട്ടുള്ള മറച്ചുവെക്കലും കപട സദാചാരവും നമ്മളെ എവിടെ കൊണ്ട് എത്തിച്ചിരിക്കുന്നു നമുക്കൊന്ന് മനസ്സിലാക്കാൻ പറ്റും. പെൺകുട്ടികൾ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞത് ആണുങ്ങൾക്ക് കല്യാണം കഴിക്കാനോ ഇപ്പോഴത്തെ പെൺകുട്ടികൾ അൾട്ടിമേറ്റ് ഡ്രീം തന്നെ മറ്റൊരാളുടെ ഭാര്യയാകാനോ പ്രസവിക്കാനോ മാത്രമല്ല അവരുടെ ലക്ഷ്യം, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ അതിൽ ഒതുങ്ങുന്നതല്ല അവരുടെ ലക്ഷ്യം. അവർക്ക് സ്വന്തം അവരെ അടയാളപ്പെടുത്താനും അവരുടെ സ്വപ്നങ്ങൾ നേടിപ്പിടിക്കാനും സമൂഹത്തിൽ എന്തെങ്കിലും മാറ്റം വരുത്താനും അങ്ങനെ ഇൻഡിപെൻഡന്റ് ആയിട്ട് കരിയർ ചൂസ് ചെയ്യാനും ആഗ്രഹമുള്ള ഒരുപാട് പെൺകുട്ടികളുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ പെൺകുട്ടികളെ ആ രീതിയിൽ മാത്രം സുഹൃത്തുക്കളെ അപ്രോച്ച് ചെയ്യുന്ന ഒരവസ്ഥയിലേക്ക് വരുന്നവരെ വ്യക്തികളായി കണ്ടുകൊണ്ട് നമ്മളൊക്കെ ലവ് ചെയ്യാനോ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നമ്മളെ പ്രൊസസ് ചെയ്യാനോ ഉള്ള ഒരു പ്രോപ്പർട്ടി ആയിട്ടല്ല, അതിനപ്പുറം സ്വന്തമായിട്ട് സ്വപ്നങ്ങളും പിന്നെ ആഗ്രഹങ്ങളും ഉള്ള ആ പിന്നെ അവരുടെ വ്യക്തിത്വ പ്രകാശത്തിന് വേണ്ടി ആഗ്രഹിക്കുന്ന അത്തരത്തിലുള്ള സമൂഹത്തിൽ കോൺട്രിബ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യാൻ ആഗ്രഹിക്കുന്ന സ്വതന്ത്ര വ്യക്തികളായിട്ട് അംഗീകരിക്കുന്ന ഒരു ലെവലിലേക്ക് നമ്മുടെ ആൺകുട്ടികൾ മാറേണ്ടതുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ അത് 2 ഭാഗത്തും ഉള്ള വിശ്വാസങ്ങൾ മാറ്റിയെടുക്കണം ഈ പ്രതിമേധാവിത്വ സമൂഹത്തിൽ. അപ്പൊ അതിനൊക്കെ തന്നെ ഒരു വേദിയാവും ഇത്തരം പ്ലാറ്റ്ഫോംസ്, ഇത്തരം ഫോറംസ്, ഇത്തരം കാര്യങ്ങൾ ഒരുമിച്ചിരുന്നുകൊണ്ട് നിങ്ങൾ കേൾക്കുകയും ഡിസ്കസ് ചെയ്യുകയും ഇന്ററാക്ട് ചെയ്യുകയും ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ തന്നെ നമ്മൾ ഈ ബാരിയേഴ്സ് കുറഞ്ഞു വരും. പരസ്പരം മനുഷ്യൻ എന്ന രീതിയിൽ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ആദരിക്കാനും കുറച്ചുകൂടെ പിന്നെ ക്രിയാത്മകരമായി പരസ്പരം ഇടപെട്ടുകൊണ്ട് ജെൻഡർ ഈക്വൽ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഹെൽത്തി ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു സൊസൈറ്റിയിലേക്ക് നിങ്ങളെ നയിക്കുവാനും അവർ ഉപകരിക്കുമെന്ന് തോന്നുന്നു. ഞാൻ പറയുന്നത് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഓഡിബിൾ ആണോ അത് കൺവേ ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ടോ എനിക്ക് അറിയില്ല. ഞാൻ പെട്ടെന്ന് വേറെ ചില പരിപാടികളിൽ നിന്ന് വന്നിട്ടാണ് നിങ്ങളുടെ അടുത്ത് ഇന്ററാക്ട് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. അപ്പോ ഈ ഒരു മെസ്സേജ് നിങ്ങൾക്കെല്ലാം കിട്ടിയെന്ന് ഞാൻ വിചാരിക്കുന്നു. അപ്പൊ ആ തരത്തിലുള്ള ഒരുപാട് പരിപാടികൾ നമ്മുടെ വകുപ്പ് നടപ്പിലാക്കുന്നുണ്ട്. നമ്മൾ വിമൻ പ്രൊട്ടക്ഷൻ ഒരു വിങ് ഉണ്ട്, ഡിസ്ട്രിക്ട് ചൈൽഡ് പ്രൊട്ടക്ഷൻ വിങ് ഉണ്ട്, ICDS എന്നൊരു വിങ് ഉണ്ട്. വിവിധ പരിപാടികൾ നമ്മൾ അതിന്റെ ഭാഗമായിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പം നിങ്ങൾക്ക് കൂടുതലും നിങ്ങളുടെ കോളേജസിൽ നമ്മൾ വിവിധ പരിപാടികളുമായിട്ട് ഇനിയും വരുമെന്ന് മാത്രം അറിയിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഇന്നത്തെ ഈ ക്ലാസ് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് നല്ല രീതിയിൽ പ്രയോജനപ്പെടപ്പെട്ട് ആൺകുട്ടികളും പെൺകുട്ടികളും തുല്യമായിട്ട് ഈ ക്ലാസ്സും അതിന്റെ ശേഷമുള്ള ഇന്ററാക്ഷനിലും പങ്കെടുക്കട്ടെ. അവരുടെ സംശയങ്ങൾ പരസ്പരം ഉന്നയിക്കപ്പെട്ട് നിങ്ങളുടെ ആൺകുട്ടികളുടെ പെൺകുട്ടികളുടെ വിഷയത്തിൽ പെൺകുട്ടികളോടൊപ്പം അതിലേറെയോ അവകാശത്തോടെയും അവരെ പ്രൊട്ടക്ട് ചെയ്യുന്ന രീതിയിലും ക്രിയാത്മകമായിട്ട് നമ്മുടെ ആൺകുട്ടികൾക്ക് ഇടപെടാൻ കഴിയട്ടെ. അതിനുള്ള വേദികളായിട്ടും കൂടി നിങ്ങൾ നല്ലൊരു ബന്ധങ്ങൾ, ബ്യൂട്ടിഫുൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ആരോഗ്യകരമായിട്ടുള്ള സൗഹൃദമായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു അന്തരീക്ഷമുള്ള ആൺ പെൺ സൗഹൃദങ്ങളുള്ള ഒരു സൊസൈറ്റിയിലേക്ക് ബിൽഡിങ്ങിലേക്ക് ഇത് സഹായിക്കുമെന്നും കൂടെ അറിയിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് ഇത്തരത്തിലുള്ള ഭാവിയിൽ തുടർന്നും ഇത്തരം പരിപാടികൾ നിങ്ങൾ ആസൂത്രണം ചെയ്യണമെന്നും അറിയിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് ഈ പരിപാടി ഔപചാരികമായിട്ട് ഉദ്ഘാടനം ചെയ്തതായിട്ട് പ്രഖ്യാപിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് നിർത്തുന്നു. നമസ്കാരം. താങ്ക് യു വെരി മച്ച്. താങ്ക് യു ഓൾ.
താങ്ക് യു മാം ഫോർ യുവർ വേർഡ്സ്. നെക്സ്റ്റ് ഫോർ ഫെലിസിറ്റേഷൻ ഐ ഇൻവൈറ്റ് കൊല്ലം പത്തനംതിട്ട റീജിയണൽ കോർഡിനേറ്റർ മിസ്റ്റർ ഷാരോസ് എച്ച്.
ആറന്മുള കോളേജ് ഓഫ് എഞ്ചിനീയറിംഗിൻ്റെ നേതൃത്വത്തിൽ സംഘടിപ്പിക്കപ്പെട്ടിട്ടുള്ള ബാലിക ലോക ബാലികാ ദിനവുമായി ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട് സംഘടിപ്പിക്കപ്പെട്ടിട്ടുള്ള വെബിനാറിൻ്റെ ഉദ്ഘാടന ചടങ്ങിലാണ് നാം ഏവരുമുള്ളത്. ഈ മീറ്റിംഗിൻ്റെ അധ്യക്ഷൻ ബഹുമാന്യനായ പ്രിൻസിപ്പൽ ഡോക്ടർ സജീവ് സർ, സ്വാഗതം പറഞ്ഞ അധ്യാപകൻ ബാലകുമാർ, ഈ വെബിനാർ ഉദ്ഘാടനം ചെയ്ത് സംസാരിച്ച പത്തനംതിട്ട വനിതാ ശിശു വികസന ഓഫീസർ പി എസ് തസ്നീം, കോളേജ് ഓഫ് എഞ്ചിനീയറിംഗ് ആറന്മുള പ്രോഗ്രാം ഓഫീസർ അനൂപ് കെ ടി, വെബിനാറിൽ പങ്കെടുത്ത് മുഖ്യപ്രഭാഷണം നടത്തുന്ന ഡോക്ടർ ഇഷാ കപൂർ, എൻ്റെ പ്രിയപ്പെട്ട നാഷണൽ സർവീസ് സ്കീം കുടുംബാംഗങ്ങളെ, വിദ്യാർത്ഥി വിദ്യാർത്ഥിനി സഹോദരങ്ങളെ, ഇന്ന് ലോക ബാലികാ ദിനം. വർഷങ്ങൾക്ക് മുൻപ് ബാലികമാരെ ജീവനോടെ കുഴിച്ചു മൂടിയിരുന്ന ഇരുണ്ട കാലഘട്ടത്തെക്കുറിച്ച് നാം കേട്ടിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഇന്ന് നമ്മുടെ നാട്ടിലെങ്കിലും, അതായത് കേരളത്തിലെങ്കിലും, നമ്മുടെ പെൺകുട്ടികൾക്ക് മാന്യമായി ജീവിക്കാനുള്ള ചുറ്റുപാടുണ്ട് എന്ന് ഞാൻ കരുതുന്നു. നമ്മുടെ നാട്ടിലെ ഒരുവിധം എല്ലാ കുട്ടികളും പ്രായപൂർത്തിയാകുന്നതോടുകൂടി അവർക്കുണ്ടാകുന്ന മെൻസ്ട്രൽ ഹൈജീനിനെ കുറിച്ച് പലതരത്തിൽ ബോധവൽക്കരണത്തിന് വിധേയരാക്കപ്പെടുന്നു എന്നുള്ളതാണ് ഞാൻ മനസ്സിലാക്കിയിട്ടുള്ള വസ്തുത. എന്നാൽ നമ്മൾ നിരന്തരം കണ്ടുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്ന സിനിമയിലും ടെലിവിഷൻ പ്രോഗ്രാമുകളിലും സ്ത്രീയെ വാണിജ്യ ചരക്കായി അവതരിപ്പിക്കപ്പെടുന്നതിലൂടെ അവരുടെ സാമൂഹികമായ അവസ്ഥകൾക്ക് കുറേ ഒരു പരിധിവരെ ഇന്നും അർദ്ധരാത്രി സമയം നമ്മുടെ റോഡിലൂടെ പെൺകുട്ടികൾക്ക് കടന്നു പോകാൻ, ഒറ്റയ്ക്ക് നടന്നു പോകാൻ കഴിയാത്ത അവസ്ഥ നിലനിൽക്കുന്നു എന്നുള്ളത് നാം ആശങ്കയോടെ തന്നെ കാണപ്പെടേണ്ട വസ്തുതയാണ്. നേരത്തെ ശിശു വനിതാ ശിശു വികസന ഓഫീസർ സൂചിപ്പിച്ചതുപോലെ അത്ര പെട്ടെന്നൊന്നും നമുക്ക് ഈ ഒരു വ്യത്യാസം ഉടനെ മാറ്റിയെടുക്കാൻ കഴിഞ്ഞില്ലെങ്കിൽ പോലും നമ്മുടെ മറ്റു നാടുകളുമായി കമ്പയർ ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ, ഉത്തരേന്ത്യൻ സംസ്ഥാനങ്ങളുമായി കമ്പയർ ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ, നമ്മുടെ നാട്ടിലെ പെൺകുട്ടികൾക്ക് അഭിമാനബോധത്തോടുകൂടി തന്നെ ജീവിക്കാൻ കഴിയുന്ന സാഹചര്യം നമ്മുടെ നാട്ടിലുണ്ട് എന്നുള്ളത് എപ്പോഴും സന്തോഷം ഉളവാക്കുന്ന കാര്യം തന്നെയാണ്. ഒരു 2018 തോന്നുന്നു ഒരു സിനിമയിൽ നിന്നും ഉത്തേജനം ഉൾക്കൊണ്ടുകൊണ്ട് പഞ്ചാബിലെ ചണ്ഡീഗഡിലെ രണ്ട് പെൺകുട്ടികൾ, കൗമാരക്കാരായ രണ്ട് പെൺകുട്ടികൾ അവരുടെ വാസസ്ഥലത്തിനടുത്തുള്ള ഒരു ചേരിയിൽ അവിടുത്തെ പെൺകുട്ടികളുടെ ശോചനീയ അവസ്ഥ, അവർക്ക് പാട് വാങ്ങാനുള്ള സാനിറ്ററി നാപ്കിൻസ് വാങ്ങാനുള്ള സാമ്പത്തിക സ്ഥിതിയില്ല എന്ന യാഥാർത്ഥ്യം മനസ്സിലാക്കിക്കൊണ്ട് വളരെ കുറഞ്ഞ ചെലവിൽ നാപ്കിൻസ് ഉണ്ടാക്കി വിതരണം ചെയ്ത ഒരു വാർത്ത പത്രങ്ങളിൽ അന്നുണ്ടായിരുന്നു. കൗമാരക്കാരായ ജാൻവി സിംഗും ലാവണ്യ ജെയിനും ഇവർ രണ്ടുപേരും തങ്ങളുടെ ആഗ്രഹം അവരുടെ മാതാക്കളോട് തുറന്നു പറയുകയും അവരുടെ ആവശ്യം യാഥാർത്ഥ്യമാണെന്നും സമൂഹത്തിന് ആവശ്യമുള്ളതാണെന്നും മനസ്സിലാക്കിക്കൊണ്ട് അവരുടെ പേരൻസ് നൽകിയ 5000 രൂപ മൂലധനമായി വെച്ചുകൊണ്ട് 2 രൂപ ചെലവിൽ സാനിറ്ററി നാപ്കിൻസ് വിതരണം ചെയ്തു. അതായത് 1000 നാപ്കിൻസ് അവരുടെ ചേരിയിൽ വിതരണം ചെയ്തതായിട്ട് അന്ന് പത്രത്തിൽ വായിക്കാൻ ഇടയായി. ഒരു പരിധിവരെ ഈ ഹൈജീനൊക്കെ നമുക്ക് ബോധവൽക്കരിക്കാൻ കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ പോലും ഇതിൻ്റെ വില താങ്ങാൻ കഴിയുന്ന ആൾക്കാരായിരിക്കില്ല നമ്മുടെ ചേരി നിവാസികളായ യുവതികൾ. അതുകൊണ്ട് തന്നെ ഇതിൻ്റെ സംഘാടകരോട് എനിക്ക് പറയാനുള്ളത്, വില കുറഞ്ഞ രീതിയിൽ തദ്ദേശീയമായി ഉൽപ്പാദിപ്പിക്കാൻ കഴിയുന്ന പാടുകളുടെ നിർമ്മാണ സാങ്കേതിക വിദ്യ കുടുംബശ്രീ പോലെയുള്ള കൂട്ടായ്മകളിലേക്ക് കൂടി എത്തുന്ന തരത്തിൽ ഇതിൻ്റെ പ്രവർത്തനം വ്യാപിപ്പിക്കുന്നതാണ് നമ്മുടെ ലക്ഷ്യം. എത്രയും പെട്ടെന്ന് സാക്ഷാത്കരിക്കുവാൻ കഴിയുന്ന മാർഗം എന്ന് ഞാൻ കരുതുന്നു. വൃത്തിയില്ലാത്ത തുണിക്കഷ്ണം ഉപയോഗിക്കുന്നതിലൂടെ നേരത്തെ നമ്മുടെ ജില്ലാ വനിതാ ശിശു വികസന ഓഫീസർ പറഞ്ഞതുപോലെ അവരുടെ ഹെൽത്ത് ഇഷ്യൂസ് ഇൻഫെർട്ടിലിറ്റിയിലേക്ക് വരെ നയിക്കാവുന്ന ഹെൽത്ത് ഇഷ്യൂസ് അവരിലേക്ക് ഉണ്ടാകുന്നു എന്നുള്ളത് വളരെ സങ്കടകരമായ വസ്തുതയാണ്. അതുകൊണ്ട് ഇങ്ങനെ ഒരു ദിവസത്തിലെങ്കിലും നമുക്ക് ഈ കാര്യങ്ങളെക്കുറിച്ച് വിശദമായി ചർച്ച ചെയ്യുവാനും നമ്മുടെ പെൺകുട്ടികൾ നേരിടുന്ന വെല്ലുവിളികൾ മനസ്സിലാക്കുവാനും സമൂഹ മനസാക്ഷിയുടെ മുന്നിൽ അത് അവതരിപ്പിക്കുവാനും കഴിയുന്നു എന്നുള്ളത് അതിനൊരു വേദി ഉണ്ടാക്കുവാൻ മുൻകൈയെടുത്ത കോളേജ് ഓഫ് എഞ്ചിനീയറിംഗ് ആറന്മുളയിലെ എൻ്റെ NSS കുടുംബാംഗങ്ങളെ മുക്തകണ്ഠം പ്രശംസിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് ഞാൻ എൻ്റെ വാക്കുകൾ ഉപസംഹരിക്കുന്നു. നന്ദി, നമസ്കാരം. ജയ് NSS.
Thank you, sir. This webinar is conducted in collaboration with an NGO, Free Paths for India, who have done many campaigns in the past. Their goal is to make basic menstrual sanitation available to everyone. Also, to put an end of clothes and rags being used during menstruation. They wish to adopt menstruators below the period poverty line and avail basic necessities such as pads to all of them until they are self-sufficient to buy menstrual products and not live a life compromising their health and hygiene. Also, to put an end to the stigma surrounding the period and to educate the future generation about the importance of menstrual hygiene. Now, to take over the session, I kindly invite the NGO coordinator.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Adya, and I would be hosting the event on behalf of Free Pads of India. So before we actually start the event, I would like to introduce my organization and what we actually do. So as Pooja rightly told you that
in India,
we fight to actually end period stigma. And how we do that? We do that by adopting menstruators below the poverty line who cannot afford basic hygiene products like pads. We adopt them. By adopting, we mean that we go to the same people every month, because periods is not something that happens once and does not happen the other month. So we go every month to the same people, to the same place, until and unless they can sustain themselves, and provide them with pads. Secondly, we work in ending period stigma. We do educational events like these. We collaborate with expert speakers, like we have Dr. Isha Kapoor today, and we talk about issues that are not spoken about, issues that are still stigmatized, and we want to break the barrier and we want open communication about that. Before we actually move forward, we would like to show you a small video.
In India, over 63 million adolescent girls do not have the access to toilets or menstrual products. Over 70% of all reproductive diseases are the result of poor menstrual hygiene. Over 23 million girls drop out of school due to periods every year. Yet pads are labeled a luxury. It is not just about periods or pads. It's about education, it's about health, and it's about basic human rights and opportunities. It's about period poverty. and we, Free Pats for India, work to eliminate the generational struggle of period poverty. Every month they struggle. Not once, not twice, but every month. This is why we don't just distribute pads, but we adopt. We make a promise to be there. Whoever they are, wherever they are, we'll be there for them, not once, not twice, but every month. Don't let periods bleed out their health, hopes and dreams. Will you help us help them? Will you stand with us?
So this is what we do, and we would love that if you could actually join us and you could also contribute. And surprisingly, adopting a menstruator actually takes just 300 rupees a year. That is less than a cup of coffee we go for every week. So we have amazing internship opportunities. We have amazing opportunities where you can actually volunteer. For all these, you can reach out directly to our Instagram page, which we would be linking below. And also, I would like to share my experience. I am an event coordinator at FPI, and I've been working for a few months with them. And I have learned more than I have actually learned throughout my school life. So this is an amazing opportunity, which all of you can definitely check out. I would like to go forward with the event and actually introduce to you our guest speaker for today, which is Dr. Isha Kapoor. She is an MBBS and she is has done a Master's of Surgery in Obstetrics and Gynecology. She is a women health awareness enthusiast and advocates for women's empowerment. She has an amazing Instagram handle and she keeps posting videos about menstrual health and other related topics. So we would love that if you can actually go check out her work. And we have linked the handle below, and you can also use your scanners and scan the presentation to reach to the handle. Now I would like to hand over to Dr. Isha if she wants to say a few words.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm so grateful and thankful for you all to organize this event and invite me over to speak. And I'm so happy to see so many people really coming forward for issues such as women health, which are spoken very less in our country. So I am very looking forward to all the questions that you have to ask me, and I think we can begin.
Before we begin, I would like to tell you all that we would love if you can actually interact with us. So I would request all of you, if it is possible, to switch on your cameras whenever you feel like, raise your hands, drop your comments in the chat session, because more the session will be interactive, more would be the fun. We don't want this to be a very boring lecture series. We would be dropping polls, we would be having questionnaires, and we really want you guys to participate. So before beginning, I would start with a bit of trivia. How do you think the term menstruation originated? You guys can actually put your answers in the chat box. We would love to hear from you. Or it would be better if you want to unmute and actually talk about it. How do you feel the term menstruation originated? Any wild guesses? You can raise your hands if you want to answer, or you can put your answers directly in the chat box. Anybody with having some idea? Thank you.
I think it's from the word menses.
Yes, very right. It is from the word menses, and very rightly answered by Pooja. What do you guys think? Some other thing, what do you think the word menses actually mean? So I'll just share some Wikipedia knowledge which I got over here. So menstruation and menses are actually derived from a Greek, from a Latin word, menses, which means month, which in turn relates to the Greek mean mene, which actually means moon, and to the roots of English words month and the moon. So that's where the word menstruation has come from. So now, just another small poll for you. How many of you feel uncomfortable while you're speaking about menstruation to your family, to your friends, to non-menstruators about periods? It is a poll, and also the polls are anonymous. We would not know your name. So there we have a poll, and you guys can answer that. It's a yes or no question. I'm getting a lot of votes for no. I would repeat, all the answers would be anonymous and we would not get to know who has replied. Okay, so I'll wait for maybe some time more and the poll would be live. You can go and choose yes or no in the poll.
There's a question in the answer box, chat box. We'll be answering that. We'll be answering that.
Yeah, we'll be coming to the questions later. So I can see a lot of people have actually chose the option of no, and that's why we do such college events to actually break the stigma so that people are more comfortable about talking to their spouses, to their family members, to their friends openly about periods and menstruation. So we'll be closing the poll right now, and we have got a lot of responses for no and a very few responses for yes. And we just wanted to know from you, because this is why we have conducted the session, so that the stigma is broken and this barrier is broken. So now I'll come to Dr. Isha and start with the most obvious question over here. What are periods? This is for the non-menstruators who have not experienced periods and maybe heard from, you know, advertisements or maybe some textbooks, but not exactly, not in layman's terms. What are periods?
Okay, so first I would really like if you could like put your videos on, because I would like to see your faces, and if you can communicate, that would be nice. So what are periods? So like every system has something that do, like they are supposed to be doing in our body. For example, respiratory system is for breathing, and digestive system is for eating and digesting food. So the reproductive system is for reproduction. So in a female reproductive system, the reproductive system is always ready, that if you want to conceive, the system should be ready. Okay, so every month, there is one, there is a thing called as ovulation, that is one ovum is released from one of the ovaries commonly, and then the system is ready for reproduction. That means if the female wants to conceive, the system is ready. So the uterus, which is uterus is the sac or the bag which is going to nurture the baby, store the baby, and give the support to the baby for 9 months after fertilization. So that uterus is ready for conception and implantation. That means if ova and sperm has met and fertilization has occurred, then the uterus should be ready. So our body keeps the uterus ready every month to receive a fertilized ovum. So when it does not receive any fertilized ovum, when there is no conception, when the patient does not become pregnant, that time the entire lining of the uterus, that is the increased blood, the lining, that is glands, the mucus, everything falls down. Because now it has no use, no purpose. It was developing because it was expecting that there will be a baby, it will have to nurture. But there is no baby this time, so it will just give away. So every month this is happening. So that's it. So now what are periods? It's just the uterine lining which is falling off because there was no pregnancy. So it is very natural and normal thing to talk about now. Like, are you just a few of you tell me, are you like getting it a little better? That's a very normal thing. The body was preparing for pregnancy, but it did not happen. So now the entire lining has fallen down and it happens every month. Okay. So those so, are the
That was actually very nice because we have always studied about it in biology textbooks, and it is, the language is so complicated that we do not actually understand half the concept. So thank you for that, Dr. Isha. And I would like to ask that at what age do the periods start and when do they end?
Okay, the periods start, we call in our medical terms, we call this menarche. So they usually start by the age of 11 to 14 years. So, but if they are till 16 years, if they have not started, we are not really too much worried about them. But usual age for starting your periods is 11 to 14 years.
And what time do they end? Till when do they last?
So there is a thing called as menopause. That is, meno means menses, pausing means stopping. So menses pausing, that is menopause. So menopause is the time when your menses are going to stop. And that is 45 to 55 years. And in Indian females, the average age is 49 years.
So the next question I actually have for you, and we also in all ways, whenever we are talking about periods, at Free Pads of India, we emphasize on the fact that we talk about not, you know, as females or males, and we talk about menstruators and non-menstruators. So can there be any case where, you know, males or transgenders also getting their periods?
Okay, so let's go to the basics. So first we learn how periods are happening. Okay, so then it becomes a very objective thing. So periods are happening because there is an axis, there is a hormonal system in our body, there is a hypothalamus, pituitary gland, then our ovaries, then our uterus, and then our external genital tract through which the blood is coming out. So there is a hormone interaction happening at the level of hypothalamus and your pituitary gland, and then your ovaries, and then uterus, and then that blood is coming out through your external genital area. So females is a term a lot of people can identify with being a female, even if they are not menstruating. Why? Menstruation will happen if everything in this axis is normal, right? Hypothalamus, pituitary, ovaries, uterus, and the external genital tract is working okay. Then the menstruation will occur, right? So it's a very physiological thing.
Yes.
But there can be trans men or non-binary people in which there is uterus and this axis is happening and then menstruation is happening. And there can be females who are not menstruating. Female as a term has to be uncoupled from menstruation. Why? Because it was originally started because feminism was the term feminism was coined, and then the females who were not menstruating or the men who were menstruating, they were getting a bit confused. So female is a very subjective thing. It is an identity specific thing. So if you identify being a female, that does not necessarily mean that you are menstruating. So because menstruation is a very physical thing.
So talking about menstruation, we talk about menstruators and non-menstruators, and not as males and females, because transgender and non-binary people who have uterus, plus also they have XY chromosome, sometimes they are also menstruating, okay?
Oh, thank you for shedding light on that, and that was really helpful. So before I actually move forward to the next question, I have a question for all those who are listening right now to my audience, that would you be comfortable about speaking about your genital problems or your partner's genital problems to the doctor? Because a lot of us are not comfortable. We get scared and we think, what will others think? Or, you know, how to communicate with that. So would you be comfortable? And the poll is there again, all the answers and polls are anonymous, and you can go and give your vote over there. So we are getting a lot of votes for yes. And till the time the poll is live, I would like to ask you, Dr. Isha, that do you actually see that a lot of non-menstruators actually accompany the menstruators when they're coming for a visit?
Yes, actually, I do see a lot of non-menstruators coming with the females or the menstruators to my clinic, to the hospital. So, the conditions are improving, and I do see a lot of people who are coming with their better half or their friends or their sisters, daughters. So I think that is something which I have observed.
So you see that the times are changing and progress is made happening. So basically the next question I would have for you is, do you feel that they are more comfortable when they are coming alone, or they are more comfortable when they're coming along with a menstruator only as compared to when they're coming with a non-menstruator?
I think they are more comfortable when they are alone, because there is still a little bit of stigma and barriers still we have to cross in our society. So they are not really open about everything when they are coming with some other person. So I think that is something we as a society can work on.
Yeah, definitely. And we do have the results, and a lot of people have actually voted for yes, and that's a very positive sign that they would be comfortable speaking about their problem or their partner's genital problem. And those who are not comfortable, we completely understand. I personally understand, and this is why all these sessions are so important. So coming to a very important topic, which is often neglected by a lot of us, that is menstrual hygiene. So before I actually go forward and move into the section, I would share some importance of clean washrooms to all those who can pee in the open. So as a girl or as a menstruator, I can relate to this, and I want to know how many of you can relate to this. So have you wore the same pad for the whole day due to the unavailability of a clean washroom? And I'm sure a lot of menstruators over here would be able to relate to this. The poll again is live, and you can answer that. We see that there are questions from the audience, and please keep on posting your questions, and we would be addressing all the questions in the end. Until now, the poll is active that have you ever wore the same pad for the whole day due to the unavailability of a clean washroom? Thank you. and I can actually see a lot of vote towards the yes side. And I think as a girl, and even Dr. Isha would agree with me, that we face a lot of problems when we are on our periods and we cannot find a clean washroom. So till we get more and more results, I would like to ask you, Doctor, how often should pads and tampons be changed? And what would happen if we don't change them very often?
First, Adya, I'd like to address that those who can pee in the open. Nobody should be peeing in open, okay? No matter if you're a menstruator, non-menstruator, you are not supposed to pee in open. Second thing, and a very important thing that I think I'll tell you today that is going to change your future narrative of this bad, unclean washroom is that in the washroom, there is no such thing as an airborne infection, okay? So you can go until and unless you have cuts on your buttocks or any area which is actually coming in contact with the seat. And in Indian washroom, there is no problem. The only problem is that obviously there might be obvious like dirt that you can see. Odor is very bad. But instead of holding your pee or not changing the pad, that is going to cause you more harm than using that unclean washroom. Because there is no airborne infection which has been proven yet that you get from a bad or unclean washroom. So you can just go do your thing and come out. Instead, if you hold your urine for a long time, you might get urinary tract infection. If you're not going to change your pad for a long time, you might get infection because of the bacteria growing on your pad. So just forget about this unclean washroom will give me some disease kind of a thing which you have in your mind. It is not going to give you any disease till you're going to lick the place or you're sitting in the place and you have a lot of cuts on it. So it is not actually harming you, but you not changing your pads for a long time, you holding back your urine for a long time is definitely going to harm you because there are researches which prove that. Now coming to how often you should be changing your pad, if you're using a sanitary pad, you should be changing it 4 to 6 hourly. And it does not matter if the pad is soaked or not soaked, you have to change it. Sometimes the girls come to me and they are like, but you know, I have very less flow, so my pad is not soaked, so should I change it? Yes, you should change it, okay? Because it has been exposed, it becomes wet, and now it has a little bit of your blood on it. So it has been exposed to the outer environment. It can have bacteria growing on it. It can lead to rashes, irritation, itching, infection. So you have to change it. If you're using a tampon, you have to change it 6 hours. Again, 6 hours, maximum 8 hours. If you are using a menstrual cup, you have to change it every, that means empty it and clean it and reinsert it every 8 hours. Not more than that. When you're sleeping, you can wear your pad for 6 hours, but then you have to change, okay?
So I guess that is a really informative a piece that basically we all menstruators think that if the pad is not soaked, we really do not need to change it. So thank you for breaking that myth for us. And, you know, we will take care of that in the future. So coming to a question that I am sure a lot of menstruators want to know over here, that which product do you feel is the best? Is there anything that is the best, or how to choose a product that fits for you?
Okay, so what are the products that are available in the market? There are sanitary pads, which we all know of. Then there are tampons. Then there are menstrual cups, which are coming to the market now. There are period panties and our old age cloth, right? In the olden time, the cloth used to be used. So basically, if you are using a product correctly, any product, if you're using it correctly, there is no proven or researched benefits that one is better than the other, okay? But you have to use it correctly. Why? Because I have used the term cloth. So cloth, if you're washing it and then drying it in the sunlight and then using it, it also has no problem. You can use it. So there has been no researches done till now, which proves that this is better than that or that is better than this. Obviously, I'm talking medically. But now from environment's point of view, sanitary pads, etc., are very hard. They take at least 500 years to like properly biodegrade. And menstrual cups are reusable, so you can use them again and again. Same applies for clothes. You can use them again and again. So basically, it is your personal preference which you are using. But medically, there has been no research which proves that this is better than that.
So we did have a question from the audience, and I would like to come to that question because it's actually very related. So the question I would like to, you know, first address is that tampons and menstrual cups are not acceptable for some people. How can we overcome this? I think she wants to, you know, address the stigma associated with using them. So how do you overcome it?
First thing which I always say is that just get your proper information. The more you are informed, the less you will be fearful, because we are always scared of the unknown. So some things which we do not know, we are we think that we are afraid of it, or we are scared of it. Tampon is nothing. You just have to, you know, your vagina is a tube, and then you have cervix and uterus above it. So vagina can have a proper tampon inserted in it, and when you are having sexual intercourse, a full-size penis can go into it. So tampon is nothing. It's just that it's a product which will absorb your menstrual blood when you'll insert it in your vagina. It has a strong string, a little string which is attached at the end, so you can remove it when you feel like it is, when the 6 hours have passed, or when you feel before 6 hours, if you feel it's completely soaked up, then you can remove it. So tampon is simple thing. The menstrual cup is a cup. Nowadays, you must have seen a lot of pictures, a lot of ads coming up with a menstrual cup. You just have to fold it, insert it in your vagina. It goes and sit on the mouth of your cervix. So it collects all the menstrual blood, and then you can remove it, discard the menstrual blood, wash it, and then use it again. So it's simple. First thing which I'll say is get proper knowledge from proper sources. Why I'm talking about proper sources? Because you should know the information which you are getting, how authentic is that. You should not go around looking at an unauthentic source of information or rumors. Second thing is talking about the stigma. I think the main stigma, which is the hymen thing, that the hymen will break. So the thing is ki, hymen can break due to a lot of things. Hymen is nothing. It's just opening of vagina. There is a very thin membrane which is like circular, and it has like a hole through which obviously our menstrual blood is coming out. So the people are like, oh my God, my hymen. So what? What if it breaks? Nothing. It can break due to so many other things also. It can break due to some injury, genital injury, or if you are masturbating, and it can break because of that also. And even if it breaks, what's the whole thing about, oh my God, my hymen must not break? And you, why is this thinking coming from? The root of this cause is this obsession of our society with hymen. Basically, your hymen is nothing. It's just a membrane. It can break due to anything. So even if it breaks due to tampon, it's like, why are we worried about it? Okay. But usually, it does not really break all the 100% of the time. But it might break, obviously, because it's a very thin membrane. It can break due to, I think, very vigorous exercise if you're doing. If there is a little bit of injury to that area, it can break due to that also. So I think the main stigma which we need to talk right now is our obsession with hymen. Why are we so obsessed with hymen? Even if it breaks, what is the point of it? Like, is it affecting you anyway? No, it's not. So I think that is how we should be handling this thing.
Very well answered. And also, is this true that not all women are actually born with a really good hymen?
Yes.
And like without any reason, without, you know, even like wearing a tampon or getting involved in a sexual act, the hymen cannot be there. And that can be there from the very start.
Yes, it can happen. It can happen.
So that is something that we really need to address, and the whole obsession with the hymen has to go. So moving forward to the next question is, do you think we require some special products or some special soaps to actually maintain the pH? Because we do have plenty of them in the market.
So our vagina is a very self-cleaning organ, and it maintains its own pH, which is acidic. So basically, if you're using too much of soap, mostly they are alkaline in nature, so you are going to obviously disturb the pH. So as a gynecologist, we do not recommend all these intimate hygiene products. Obviously, they claim that they will help you in maintaining pH, but the vagina does not require any help. It is obviously self-cleaning organ. What we suggest is washing it with plain water. When you're taking a bath, the soap flows down and then you can just wash with plain water. And that's about it. Vagina does not really require any other thing helping it for its cleanliness. Another important thing which I like to tell all my females or girls out here is that you are not supposed to wash your vagina or douche or put anything, any water for the purpose of cleaning inside your vagina. Vulva is the area which you can see. You can only clean your vulva, okay? Vulva means whatever you can see when without inserting your fingers. For example, labia majora, minora, mons pubis, this is your vulva. Wherever you have pubic hair, that is your vulva. You are just supposed to wash the vulva. You are not supposed to wash your vagina. Vagina is the tube in which you, when you are coming to a gynecologist, we are doing an examination, or when you are having sexual intercourse, the penis is inserted, all from the area from where your menstrual blood is coming from. That area you're not supposed to wash. It is self-cleaning. It will cleanse itself. So you are just supposed to wash your vulva. That too, plain water will do. You're not supposed to. We do not recommend that you go and buy some intimate hygiene product. So it is basically your own wish if you want to. So that's about it.
Okay. And so that is actually, this information was really required because there is a whole wave of menstrual products around the market. And every menstruator is worried whether we should be adopting it or not adopting it. So thank you for shedding light on that. So next, I would like to know your views about period panties. This is something that is very new to India. And how do you feel? Are they more comfortable? Are people adopting them? Or are there any advantages or disadvantages?
First, I'd like to go back to your thing that there's a wave of all these intimate hygiene things coming up in the market. It's basically marketing, intimate hygiene product. I have heard about intimate whitening creams. Oh my God, you don't need that. Do not do that. It's just like, you know, there is a lot of products being pushed into the market on the name of beauty. Like, you have to look this way. Why do you have to look that way? You are good the way you are. I mean, just like there are fairness creams in the market, like, you have to look this way to be pretty. Your vagina is not supposed to be white or cleaned up or be smelling nice. It is, just leave it alone. It is a self-cleansing organ. It will be there the way it is. You don't need to buy a lot of things just because marketing experts are pushing it into the market just to get your money. They basically just play on your insecurities. So don't give into it. You don't require all these things. What was the next question you asked me?
The next question I actually asked you, that what are your views on period panties?
Yeah, so period panties, basically, what are they? They are panties, and at the area of your vagina, there is a stuffing and products or the material which can absorb your period blood. So it's a very nice thing because it is sustainable. It is you can wash it and reuse it again and again. And I think for our females, you can start with the days which are when you have a lighter flow. For example, fourth or fifth day, you can try and check out for yourself if it is working for you or not. And if it is working for you, then well and good. You can wear it, and then you have to wash it, and then you can wear it again. So it's a very good product which has come in the market, but you have to try it for yourself to see if it is working for you or not.
So that is a very good suggestion. I would like to take a question that I've got from the audience. So what is the ideal age when we can actually start using menstrual cups? And I would like to add on the question, please answer this for tampons as well. So what is the ideal age when we can, you know, start using menstrual cups or tampon, or is there an ideal age?
Okay, there is no ideal age to start using menstrual cup or tampon, but we say when a person becomes a major, for example, 18 years, they can decide for themselves, because the young children, they might not be in a position to properly take a decision about what product they want to use. But medically speaking, there is no ideal age to start using these things, but you can start using after 18, I think.
Okay, so also we have a very interesting question, and something that has a lot of stigma around it. We have it from one of our audience members. Do you think that masturbation actually affects periods?
No, not at all. I mean, no, this is the biggest myth ever. Dude, I told you how your periods work. Hypothalamus, pituitary, ovary, uterus, external genital tract. It's a very complicated system. Do you think a thing such as masturbation is going to actually affect your periods? Obviously, it's not. It is not affecting. But said that, having sexual intercourse during your periods can give rise to a lot of infections. Why? I'll tell you the reason why. Because usually our vagina maintains a acidic pH. So it has this ability to kill all the pathogens which are coming to infect it. But during menses, this pH is not maintained as an acidic. It becomes a little bit towards the basic side. So your immunity is reduced. That's why it is said that during periods, you must not have a sexual intercourse. But if you have clean hands and you are just masturbating, it is fine. It is not going to affect your periods in any way. If you are masturbating before your periods, after your periods, anytime, it is not really affecting your periods.
Okay. So thank you for that answer. And I move on to my next question. Can periods have a foul smell? And if yes, is that normal?
Okay, so by and large, what is period? Period is just the lining which I talked about earlier, that the uterine lining, a little bit of glandular structures, a little bit of mucus is coming out. Usually, per se, it does not have a smell, but your pad, when it gets soaked, it is exposed to external environment. Pathogens can act on it, and then foul smell can come. So if foul smell is coming, that means you have to change your pad. It should not be foul smelling per se. Okay,
so if is there a possibility that we can actually have a foul smelling blood, like not the foul smelling pad due to the longevity of the pad, but foul smelling blood?
No, not. You cannot have, like, usually you do not have a foul smelling period blood. It is because of the stasis, and when the blood is exposed to the outside environment, then it can have a typical odor to it, then it develops an odor. But per se, just plain menstrual blood, when it is not exposed to an outside environment, it does not have any foul smell.
Okay, thank you for shedding light on that one. So I would be moving to my next section. Next section, and that is actually about myths regarding periods. And we have busted, I guess, a lot of myths already, but I would still like to, you know, bust a few more with your help, doctor. So basically, before I start with this, I would like to ask the audience, like, what are the common myths you guys have heard about your periods? Like, I'll go first. I have heard it from people that we should not water the plants, you know, during periods, or we should not go to the temples while we are on periods. And there are a number of myths relating to that. So you can drop your answers in the chat box, or you can drop your answers in the question answer section also if you want to be anonymous. And you can actually tell us about the popular myths that you have heard of. And also, again, the answers would be anonymous, so you can actually come and participate. So this is actually, somebody has written that entering the kitchen while we are on our periods is actually not safe. And this is something that is practiced in a lot of households. So do you think that there is any scientific reason behind any of the myths?
Actually, there have been no proven study which proves that a menstruating female is releasing some pheromones or some toxins. The plant doesn't know you're menstruating. You can water the plant. You can go to the kitchen, you can pray. I pray, I do everything. You can touch the pickle, everything. I'll tell you where these myths are coming from. In very, very, very olden ages, the menstruating women, obviously, when you are menstruating, you are not in your adequate health or full health. You require a little bit of rest. So that time, they had to like walk miles to like go and collect stuff and then cook food and then go to a faraway temple. So that time it was said that do not go to the temple because you are menstruating. So you can take rest. Like it was a positive thing, which has now descended to something which has become anti-females or anti-menstruators during their menstruation, because I think our society went a little patriarchal in the between. So in the olden time, it was just to give a little bit extra rest to the menstruator. They used to say, ki do not, you know, cook during these 5 days. You don't need to go to the temple. You can take rest, you know, in your like cozy space in the house. So I think that is how it originated. And now it has like gotten like interpreted, reinterpreted, and then become the today's version of myth. There is no scientific data which proves that a menstruating female is releasing any pheromone, toxin, anything. You can cook food, you can touch the pickle, you can go to the mandir, you can go to the wherever you want, you can water the plant, you can do whatever you want. If you are okay, feeling okay, if you think you can do everything, you do everything.
So that is actually very interesting how something that was released, you know, it started from by supporting the menstruators has actually gone against them and now is restricting them to do so many things. And we really need to, I guess, understand that periods are just something very normal and it's just a normal biological process. So moving on to my next question is that, is period blood different from the blood coming from a cut? So for example, if I actually get a cut on my hand or a bruise and the blood coming from period, is that different in composition or is it the same?
I've already told you 2-3 times that, you know, it is the uterine lining, glands and little bit of mucus. So this blood is just pure blood. That blood is all the nutrients which our uterus was collecting for the baby. So basically it is more or less a little bit more extra components are there in the menstrual blood. But there is no such things like this is a pure blood, that is an impure blood, nothing. It's just ki uterine lining, a little bit of blood, a little bit of mucus is there extra in the menstrual blood. And in the cut, you just have plain blood.
So we can actually say that the myth that the period blood is dirty is actually, you know, not true.
No, period. How can period blood be dirty? Your uterus was waiting for the baby to come. So it is the purest environment it has created to like nurture a baby. How can that blood be dirty?
Okay, so it is said that swimming and periods can't exist together, but now we have so many new products. So is that still valid?
Actually, swimming and periods can exist together. You can use tampons. If you are using pad, there is a point. There is a chance of leakage, and it is not very convenient to use pads and hygienic also to use pads in the swimming pool. But if you are using a menstrual cup or a tampon, you can have. You can very well go and swim. And when you are swimming, it is very good because you know the excessive flow which you are having, it helps in that also. It releases a lot of endorphins, and it is good. If you can use tampon and menstrual cup and you can swim.
Okay, so after hearing this, I guess I will not stop my swimming lessons the next time I'm on my periods. So next myth that we come, like we hear very often, is that we lose enormous blood during periods. Is that true?
So in a normal menstrual cycle, the range is 5 to 80 ml. And roughly you are losing 35 ml of blood in your periods in an entire cycle. That is, if you are bleeding for 5 days, then you will be bleeding roughly around 35 ml in all these 5 days. Like complete 5 days is equal to 35 ml. If you are bleeding more than 80 ml of blood in one cycle, then you have to get investigated. That is not normal. So obviously you can bleed more, but then that is not normal. In a normal menstruation, you will be bleeding not more than 80 ml of blood in one cycle.
So I do have a question for you. So how do we know if the blood, like amount of blood, is actually normal? So how many soaked baths can one have in, you know, say 5 days?
So roughly speaking, your pad, the normal pads which are in the market, when they soak 5 to 10 ml of the blood, then they become full. So if your pad is getting full, that means you can roughly estimate that this is like 5 to 10 ml of blood, and overnight 10 to 15 ml of blood. So number of pads, how many number of pads you are changing in one day, you should take a note of that. If you are changing one pad every 2 hourly, that means you are having extremely heavy bleeding, then you have to get yourself investigated. If you are feeling weak, physically, socially, emotionally, mentally, anytime, you have to get yourself investigated, because usually you should not be having too much problem. So you have to get investigated.
Okay, so we have another question, that periods date do change very irregularly. You know, sometimes it's 20th of the month, next time it's 15th, the other month it's 30th. So what's the reason behind it?
Okay, so first I'll tell you what normal menstruation is, like what do we call normal in our medical terms. So we call it like you should be bleeding from 2 to 8 days. 2 to 8 days is the range. Usually females bleed for 4 days, 2 to 8 days. Every 21 to 35 days, your cycle can be as short as 21 days or as long as 35 days, plus minus 7 days. That means you can have 7 days earlier or 7 days later, it will be considered normal. It should be regular, like it should come every month, roughly speaking. It should be painless. That means not absolutely painless. Obviously, I have yet to meet a menstruator who says that I have complete painless menses, but it should not incapacitate you. Usually, there is a little bit of pain, that is, we call in our medical term dysmenorrhea, on first and second day of the cycle. And you should be bleeding moderately. Moderately means not more than 80 ml in one cycle. So now coming to your irregularity of the period. So basically your periods are not irregular per se. 21 to 35 days, anytime. For example, if you are bleeding every 23 days, then that is fine. And plus minus 7 days means if you had your periods on 10th of last month and you are expecting it on 10th of this month, then 7 days earlier and 7 days later than 10th of this month is also normal. It will not be considered abnormal. Now you are talking ki why it is happening that way, because it is a complex system. I told you there are so many hormones, so many feedbacks involved. There is hypothalamus, pituitary, ovary, uterus. So sometimes it can vary, but it should not be varying for more than 7 days, and your cycle should not be less than 21 days or more than 35 days. You have to get yourself investigated then. So first you need to know if they are actually irregular or they are actually a little bit here and there, but they are falling in the category of normal menses according to our researchers.
Okay, so thank you. I guess the plus minus 7 days logic would actually, you know, be very helpful for a lot of menstruators out there. So before I move to the next question, I would like to ask the audience that, have you ever been told, beware, I'm PMSing? Or has anybody used the term that I am PMSing, or maybe she's PMSing? So the poll is open for everybody. Please drop in your answer. So please drop in your words, and we would love to hear from you. So still times, we actually get the results of this poll. Many feel, Dr. Isha, many feel that PMS is not real. So I would like to ask you medically, is it real, or is it something that we have just made up?
No, PMS is very, very real. PMS is very real. Nothing has been made up. It's just like, you know, in our society, people say the psychiatric illnesses are made up. No, they are not made up. Just like PMS is absolutely not made up. It's a proper term which has been defined in our literature, in all our books, and researches have been done on it. So it is not a made up term. Premenstrual syndrome is a real thing, and it happens.
Okay, so we do have the results, and it is actually a 50-50 ratio of people saying yes and no. So a lot of people do hear the term a lot. For those who have not ever heard it, or those who don't know what PMS is, what is PMS? And what happens during PMS?
I'm very surprised that this is a co-ed college and 50% people have not heard about PMS. You don't have enough friends who are girls, or you don't have girlfriend. Like, what is the matter? PMS is a real thing. It's a premenstrual syndrome. It is basically a condition of distressing physical, psychological and behavioral pattern which we observe in the second half of the cycle. That is after ovulation. In our medical terms, we call this luteal phase. So for non-medical people, I'll say ki before menses, the 14 days period, whatever it is, a little bit, I think that is the rough range which we can pick. There are severe distressing symptoms which a female can or cannot experience. So what are these symptoms and why are these happening? They are usually happening because of progesterone dip. There's a hormone dip, hormone imbalance is happening. And what are the things which you can expect? So there are mood swings, irritability, anxiety, depression, crying spells. Obviously, not everybody who is going to get everything. But some people may get it more severely. Other females cannot have it at all. So it's a range. And other symptoms, for example, bowel disturbances, constipation, diarrhea, these all things you can have. If somebody is suffering from migraine, they can have a premenstrual migraine. So these are all the things, bloating, weight gain, water retention. You can observe your swelling of hands and feet. So these are all the things, a wide variety of symptoms which you can observe in your premenstrual syndrome.
So now since people got to know about premenstrual syndrome, I would actually like to ask the audience, the menstruators basically. So what are the things like you would want people around you, your partners, your friends or people who are not menstruators to do for you? What do you want? Like, as a menstruator, what do you expect? How can they be supportive while you are PMSing? You can drop your answers in the chat box. Or as a non-menstruator, what do you feel you can actually do to actually help the menstruator? We have one answer that says we should be more empathetic. And I guess that that is very important. That should be the first step towards handling any problem for that matter. And some chocolates may help. I guess chocolates would definitely help. Personally, if somebody gives me chocolates, I would love that. And I would like to hear from other menstruators as well. What would be their comfort thing? What would actually help them while they are PMSing?
There are 174 people, so you better be answering.
Yeah, we have an answer from an audience that understand, and actually that is a very important thing because half of the people don't even feel that it is real. So yes, we do need a lot of understanding, all menstruators, and I'm saying this representing all the menstruators, that whenever we say that we have a problem, please try and understand, we are not making it up. We do not want your sympathy, but your understanding. Not disturbing during that period of time, that is totally relatable. Respect, obviously, yes, that to just, you know, have understanding and respect, and that is the basis of everything. Yeah, and we have another response that says maybe just understand the mood swings, that is unbearable. And that, as a menstruator, I would agree.
Another thing which I'll add is you should be understanding yourself too. So with all the menstruator, what happens is we do not know that we are PMSing and we are getting so distressed. Oh my God, what is happening? And little triggers are making us cry. Tell me how many of the menstruators have cried for a very trivial thing and then realized, oh my God, I was PMSing. So what I suggest is that you have to track your cycles. If you'll track your cycles, for example, it's a very simple thing. If you have started menstruating from today, make it as day one in your phone. Everybody has a phone. So in the notes app, you go and mark that, okay, this is the day of day one. So eventually you will have like a data of yourself for like 5 to 6 months and you will get a rough idea of when you are going to menstruate. So previous to that menstrual dates, you will know that this is the time I'm going to have a PMS. So you will be more understanding towards yourself. Instead of like getting validation from other people and asking them to understand you, I think the main call of the hour is for us to understand ourselves. Sometimes it has happened that I was PMSing and when I was not tracking my period, I didn't know that I was PMSing. So I was crying from random things and getting anxious. And then I got my period and I was like, oh my God, it was just PMS. So that should not be happening to you now after this session. You should start tracking your period and know that you're going to PMS. So you can handle yourself in a better way.
So I guess the pro tip for all the menstruators right here is to actually track your periods and know when you're actually PMSing. And definitely for the non-menstruators and also the menstruators, to in general be more understanding, respecting people and asking what they want during the time of PMS. So I move to the last section of this session, and before that I would like to have a poll with all the audience that have you ever been scared of missing or having a delayed period? And as a girl, I have been, and this has happened to me a lot. So I would like to know from all of you, or from the non-menstruators as well, have you ever, you know, heard or seen your friends who actually menstruate getting worried about their delayed periods or them not getting periods? The poll is live and we would love to have your votes. And till the time they are voting, we have already addressed that we should have a plus minus seven gap. But I would like to know that if, you know, the gap is exceeded and even after 7 days, we do not get our periods. So what is the reason of missing the periods? What is the reason of the delay?
There are a lot of causes because of which you can miss your period. But I like and go back to that our previous question, and then I'll come back to this question. So the question was, how can non-menstruators help? Non-menstruators can help by being empathetic, by being knowing that this is what is happening. And do not say it is not real, because it is real. Okay. Another thing, menstruators, you can handle yourself and be such strong in your way that you do not need other person to validate you and give you some. So the girls who said, ki, leave me alone, were my favorites. They were like, I'll handle it on my own. You just know about it and I'll take care of it. So that is the way we should be going. Now coming to missing your period. So there can be a lots of reasons for missing your period. First and the most common is pregnancy. So what I tell all my patients is that if you are not using a contraception, you are planning a baby. So if you are sexually active, you have to use contraception. You cannot say, ki, no, I am very, the frequency is very less. We have other things like we have emerge IPIL or emergency contraceptive we can rely on. No. Or we can terminate the pregnancy. No. If you are sexually active and you are not using a contraception, you are basically planning a baby. First thing which we most commonly see is pregnancy. But there are so many other causes for missing your periods too, which happens when you're not pregnant. First and the most common is stress, lifestyle changes, a lot of weight loss or weight gain. If you have shifted to a new diet, then also you can have missed periods. If you have severe anemia, for example, you have less blood in your body, then reproductive function is a very necessary function in our body. Okay, it does. You do not require to reproduce just like you require to breathe. So if you are having any nutrition, severe nutrition deficiency or anemia, that is hemoglobin deficiency, you will not be bleeding because your body knows that this is an necessary thing. I can postpone it for later. Right now, I need to survive. I need to go on a survival mode. If you are having any chronic illness, again, you have very low nutritional status. So, and very low health status, what should we say? So you can again miss your period because of that. And anything which is affecting your that axis, and now it is heavy medical term, so I'll not like bore you with them, but anything which is affecting your hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis is going to cause a missed period.
Do you think, okay, before actually moving to the next question, I would like to ask this to the audience, that have you been ever afraid of a random spotting on the day you decide to wear white or a very light colored cloth? I guess that happens with a lot of menstruators, and we do keep emergency pads in our bags always with us. So the poll is live, and it is for the non-menstruators as well. Have you ever heard or seen in your family members or the, you know, menstruators around you deciding not to wear white or a light colored cloth, you know, during your period, or just being afraid of random spotting? And when we are actually talking about random spotting, till the time we get the poll results, my question is to Dr. Isha, what is the reason for random spotting between, say, two menses, two cycles? Some girls do experience just random spotting, just say for some hours or a day. What is the reason behind that?
Okay, the first I'll talk on that I'm very scared of wearing white. Why? Even if you stain your white, what is going to happen? For example, I'm wearing a beautiful white dress. I got out of my house and then I scratched my elbow and it has now like a little bit of blood on my white dupatta. Am I going to be scared of it? Am I going to be embarrassed about it? No, it's just blood on my dupatta. That's fine, right? Why are we creating such stigma around, oh my God, my menstrual blood should not touch my white clothes? So first you should be, why are we so worried about it? Even if it's a little bit of spotting here and there, it has messed up your clothes a little bit, it is fine. It's just normal physiological thing. Another thing why it is happening, is there is a thing called as, obviously for irregular menses, there are a lot of other reasons. But I'll talk of the physiological cause which can happen. On the day of your ovulation, that is your 14th day from your day of menses, that like, backward we counted. So roughly speaking, mid-menstrually, you will have ovulation. And that time, sometimes some females might have a little bit of spotting. That is their ovulation spotting. So that is, I think, what you're talking about. But other causes, there are n number of causes for irregular menstruation that can happen. And don't be worried about staining your clothes. It's just your menstrual blood. Nothing to be worried about it. And that's it.
So we actually have a lot of votes, and there are only I have only 3 votes that actually says that they're not worried when they wear white on a day when they're expecting their period. So I guess we all need to change our mindset and, you know, be more accepting of periods and feel that it is a very normal process and there is nothing wrong with that. So
saying that, we don't need to wear white because we know we are going to bleed, and that is the favorite white dress. We know that we are going to bleed. So we are not going to wear white because we don't want our dress to be spoiled and not because we are embarrassed about it. So your reasons for not wearing light colors should be right. I'm not saying ki, no, Dr. Isha has said I have to wear light color. No. You can wear whatever you want, but your reason for wearing it should be right.
So basically the stigma should be ended and we should wear whatever we want to and however we feel like. So coming to the very, some few more questions that a lot, I guess every menstruator only leaving a few behind, experience some sort of cramps, backaches, stomach aches, you know, sometimes it's headaches, acidity, bloating, and many other symptoms. So what do you feel that can we inculcate some lifestyle changes and something that actually reduces them and we get less of those cramps during menstruation?
There is you can have premenstrual syndrome, which can have all these symptoms, or during menses also, you can have all these symptoms. So first thing is, whatever symptom you're having, it will be increased by many fold if you're stressed. So first thing is proper education, and you should be stress free. Second thing, if you are having cramps, then you can use hot water bath. You can use mefenamic acid or any other tablet which has been written by your doctor. You can take rest, a little bit of light exercise, yoga, meditation, dancing, listening to good music is going to help release nice endorphins, and it is going to help with the pain. If you're having acidity, then you should not eat very hot and spicy and caffeine and alcohol and tea. And so basically manage your symptoms and it will go away. But if it is distressing you, then go and talk to your doctor.
Okay, so also many times periods are accompanied by extreme fatigue. So is there any reason for that? Is that normal or should we be concerned?
Periods should not be accompanied by extreme fatigue. If you are facing extreme fatigue, that means you need to go talk to your doctor, get yourself investigated. It might be one of the symptoms of your anemia, that is low hemoglobin, or any other underlying disorder. So you should not take it lightly. Your periods per se are not coming with extreme amount of fatigue. They are a very natural physiological thing. You can have pain, obviously. I'm not saying it's going to be painless, but you're having any symptom which is going in excess. If you're bleeding for more days, if you're having a lot of pain, if you're having a lot of bleeding, if you're having a lot of weakness, go and talk to your doctor and get yourself checked.
Thank you for that. So is there any association between periods and bowel movement, which might lead to, say, constipation or loose motions?
Yes. As I said, premenstrual syndrome also has constipation, loose motions, bowel disturbances. Your menses, during your menstruation also, you can have constipation, loose motions. There is a thing called as prostaglandin, which is released during your menstruation, which has effect on bowel movement also. So yes, you can have that is a very common thing which we observe, that it can affect your bowel movement.
I'm sorry, I was on mute. So thank you for that. So the next question I actually have is that, you know, when do we know that the menstrual cramps or whatever is happening to us, our headaches or say acidity, is unbearable, and we actually, that is a sign for worry and we need to, you know, get ourselves examined, or it is unusual? When would we get to know?
What I tell all my patients is, listen to your body. Every person has a different threshold. So listen to your body. Do not listen to anything else. If you think, now I think I am having a lot of cramps and this is not like getting okay on its own. Hot water bag is not helping. Resting is not helping. The tablet is not helping. You go. Okay. You do not wait for anything. Every person has their own different threshold. You should always listen to your body. If you feel you should go to a doctor, go to a doctor. Do not wait ki itna hoga tabhi main doctor ke paas jaunga. Prevention is better than cure. Over investigation is better than having a disease which is not curable now. So what I say is, your body is going to speak for itself. And baki I've told you about normal menstruation. So anything which is deflecting from that, 2 to 8 days, 5 to 80 ml, 21 to 35 days, should be moderate flow and painless. Anything deflecting from it, you should go and talk to your doctor.
Okay, so thank you for that. I do not have any more questions from you, but we would definitely want the audience to interact. And if anybody has any questions, you can post in the question answer segment. You can unmute and ask the question directly or put it in the chat box, whichever way you feel comfortable. But we welcome all your questions, and we are really excited to hear them. for the time being, we do have a question till the time we can get more questions, is that can UTI and anemia lead to irregular periods?
So anemia can very well lead to irregular menstruation. As I said, ki if you do not have blood in your body decides ki reproduction is a very necessary thing to do. So it will obviously postpone your menstruation, cause menstrual irregularities. Urinary tract infection per se cannot affect your menstruation. But if you're having urinary tract infection for a long time, then that becomes a chronic illness. And then that can affect your menstruation. But per se, it won't. But if it is for a longer duration of time, it is affecting your general health, then obviously it is going to affect your menstruation.
Okay, so the question, we are open for any other questions from the audience. If you want to ask any other question or any other query or just want to talk about your own experience, we would love to hear that. So we actually have a very interesting question. So that we have a question that his brother is of adolescent age and he's pretty sure that he has no clue about menstruation. What can, like, how can we educate him and prevent him, like, that so that he does not believe in myths and, you know, he does not...
So ask him to follow my Instagram page, Isha Gynacare, and I talk a lot about menstruation and everything related to women's health there. And there are a lot of male followers also. It's a new page. So we are adding people. Ask him to follow it and I'll clear everything for him.
Okay, so I don't think so. We have any other questions for now. So I would like to wrap up this session, but before that we would really want you guys to come and check both of the handles, Dr. Isha's handle and our handle, Free Fats for India, and we have our feedback form. Please give us a feedback so that we can improve the next time we present to a college, we are, you know, doing an educational event. We would love to hear from you. Please, you can use the QR codes on the screen and scan them and follow our pages and you will see actually content that related to menstruation, related to sex education, related to menstrual awareness in general on both the handles.
And thank you for being here, 178th student. If the attendance was compulsory, then kudos to you. But if it was not compulsory and 176 people are there, then super kudos to you.
We would also like to thank Dr. Isha for collaborating with us and giving her valuable time, her incredibly amazing knowledge about menstruation, about menstrual hygiene, and busting all the myths we had for periods. And I would like to hand over to the college for continuing the program. Thank you.
Thank you, Adhya, for presenting it so well. And thank you, Dr. Isha. This was very informative and it was a beautiful session. Thank you once again. As a token of love, we are presenting a virtual memento to NGO Free Path for India.
Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much. And somebody asked me if I'm from Delhi. No, I'm not from Delhi.
Thank you. Now,
on behalf of Free Paths for India, I would really like to thank College of Engineering Arunmala for actually presenting us with this honor.
Thank you. Last but not the least, for word of thanks, I would like to call upon Program Officer of NSS Unit 618, Mr. Anoop Sir.
Manasanavate, respected Principal Dr. Sajeev V, College of Engineering, Aramura, Ms. Tasni P.S., District Women and Child Development Officer, Pathanamthitta, Mr. Shara Sach, NSS Regional Coordinator, Kollam Pathanamthitta Region, Dr. Isha Kapoor, NGO Free Parts for India, and my dear volunteers. This is the first NSS state level program conducted by College of Engineering Aramula in this academic year. And it is a great pleasure to be a part of this program. I am here to express my sincere thanks to all dignitaries and to all whom patiently attended this program. Firstly, I express my sincere gratitude to our principal, Dr. Sajeev V, who has given the permission for conducting this program. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Then secondly, on behalf of everyone, I express my sincere gratitude to Ms. Tasni P.S., District Women and Child Development Officer, Pathanamthitta, who inaugurated this program and gave us a gracious inaugural speech. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Then I would like to thank our NSS Regional Coordinator, Kollam Pathanamthitta Region, Mr. Shara Osage, who gave us a wonderful felicitation speech to this program. Thank you, sir. Next, on behalf of everyone, I express my sincere gratitude to Dr. Isha Kapoor, who has handled very informative and effective session in this program. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. And finally, our sincere thanks to my dearest NSS volunteers who have attended this program very patiently. So with this, I conclude my speech. Thanks for each and everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Before concluding, the main goal of this webinar was to educate each one in the society about menstruation and menstrual hygiene, and hope we have succeeded in it. As a part of it, we are conducting a campaign, Free Napkin to the Rural Girls, with an NGO, Free Pads for India. This campaign is open for all colleges and consists of two phases. Phase one consists of distributing sanitary pads to the tribal and the rural girls. And the phase two consists of not just providing the sanitary pads, but also taking a class for creating awareness among them about how to fight period stigma and menstrual hygiene, to empower women to put their hygiene requirements as a priority and to break taboos. Also to push people to openly discuss about menstruation and to make them understand that being on period is not impure. After completing the campaign, video of the same in not more than 10 MB should be sent to us. Cash prizes worth Rs 2000 will be rewarded to the best colleges campaign among them. Time period of 1 month will be given for completing this campaign, which starts from today. The reminder for the submission of video will be announced later. So guys, don't wait. Let's make a change and break the walls of the period poverty. Registration link for the campaign will be provided. Everyone do register as soon as possible and don't miss this opportunity. Thank you, everyone. Officially, this meeting comes to an end. Thank you once again. Everyone can now leave this meeting.
Pooja, before you actually end this meeting, I would like to answer a question that was addressed for my organization, that why we do not provide menstrual cups. So the women or the menstruators we are adopting are from not from very privileged background. They are not from backgrounds that are very socially accepting. For them, periods is still a very big taboo. And that's why we want to, you know, have all these educational sessions reach every part of India and actually educate people that periods is something that is very normal. It is not to be ashamed of. It is not something, you know, you need to feel worried about. And same is the concept of hymen, that we be actually discussed in this conversation with Dr. Isha too. So if we actually start distributing them and giving them menstrual cups, yes, I agree that they are very environment friendly, but the women or the menstruators we are adopting are very hesitant to actually use them. They are stigmatized, and we need to break the stigma, and then only we can start giving menstrual cups or, you know, other environmental friendly products. We are totally in favor of them, and that's why we want to end the stigma before and empower them to make that choice that they can actually choose menstrual cups and feel no shame about it.
Okay, thank you, Athea. Okay, that's it, and this meeting has been come to an end. Everyone can now leave the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you so much.